We are delighted to have a wonderful group of panelists to follow up the absolutely terrific conversation that was started with Peter, Sophia, and Adriana, and we want to continue that. So if you did not have a chance to ask your question during the Q&A discussion period, please bring it back to the table. There's a certain sense of free association and connection and synergy that we will build throughout the day. It's a great pleasure to have Cesar Ernesto Abadia Barrero with us. He teaches in anthropology and human rights at the University of Connecticut. And we have our own Raphael Frankfurter, a recent graduate. And pardon, forgive me, but I tend to say one of my best students ever and the one who disobeyed me the most. Okay, goes together, right? Okay, so it's a great pleasure to have Rafi with us. He's the executive director of Well Body Alliance of Sierra Leone. He has been at the forefront of the public debates and also interventions in Sierra Leone in terms of Ebola possible control and care. And we are very privileged to have Janet Curry with us today. She's the director of the Center for Health and Wellbeing, and we are deeply grateful for all your support in this past few years, the Princeton-Brazil Partnership, but also in the Global Health Program. And Janet is also the chair of the Department of Economics. So she's an amazing health economist. And so we want to have also a blend of perspectives and questions coming from various fields to inform our broader discussion on visions of care. So same procedure, we'll begin with Cesar, about 15, 20 minutes, then Rafi, and then we'll hear some comments and questions from Janet, and then we'll open up to you all.
So, hello everybody. Thank you again, as everybody's saying, to Ricardo and Joao for bringing this together, for allowing us to think and to share and to learn from all the experiences. It's been great, and we'll continue to be like that, we hope. So, I'm going to share with you just a little piece of a longer, almost 10-year collaborative, active-oriented research ethnography with the oldest child and maternity hospital in Colombia. And so the story that I want to tell you is a little bit about a particular medical innovation and what happened during the neoliberal times. We heard from Clara that in Chile under Pinochet's dictatorship was the country that followed more closely the structural adjustment policies from international lending institutions, and Colombia is a particular case because it was probably one of the few countries around the world that really implemented a full privatization of the healthcare system in the 90s. And so my idea has been to follow what happened with these traditional institutions as this has been going on. And I have this picture of that child and maternity hospital just to mention that the history of this hospital is much larger than, of course, market-based healthcare reform that were also mentioned in the previous panel. The history goes back to the 17th century colonial times when the Spanish crown really have important medical complex settlements linked to important religious affiliations like the St. John's. So there was one in the in Lima, one in Mexico, and one in Colombia, and they got to be one of the largest social welfare institutions all around Latin America. And so these countries have a very long history, followed kind of side-by-side history with the country through its independence and republican periods. But the part that I want to emphasize from this history is that it was at this hospital where modern medicine arrived. And the modern medicine that arrived at the turn of the 19th century and over the whole 20th century is that modern medicine that was brought initially from the European hegemony of medical care. So we have here even the architecture of those large French pavilions that were considered what was important, the shifted modes of thinking of what health and disease was at that time. And then in the mid 20th century, the hegemony shifted to the US. So we have in these very nice, open, large pavilions with grass area, they built an 8-story, 500-bed US kind of a dominant architectural paradigm. And it's just right there in the heart of the country. So with this background story, I want to tell you a little bit about the Kangaroo Care Program for those of you who work in issues around primary care or maternal and child medicine, neonatology, prenatology. Probably this is well known to some of you. For some of those who are not, I'll tell you a little bit about it. And I'm trying to play with this concept of post-colonial medical innovation in terms of thinking what do we make with these issues that are coming from the post-colonialism, in particular issues of how do we care for others in the medical field in a context of a very complex and convoluted history of the post-colonies as they change from their roles as in the new uptake, for example, of global markets in global health. So there is something there that these stories can tell us and help us think through. So we have this maternity hospital, and let's just imagine a picture of that. Since they were religiously affiliated, the majority of the care was charity-based care. So for example, in the 1920s, 90% of the care was charity-based, so the hospitals were not really making any money. All the funding came from the governments over those times, right? And so if you jumped to the 60s, 35% of births in the city happened at the hospital. So you have a hospital that provided charity-based care, a changing global economy at the time in the interwar periods and in the post-war periods, a lot of babies being born there. And so you have a situation that in the 60s, even though the hospital reached 120 newborn beds and 80 incubators at that time, it was the largest and most important perinatology and neonatology complex in Colombia and certainly of most of Latin America. Babies of not only of the city, but all over the country, of mothers with high-risk pregnancies would go to the hospital to have the babies delivered for the care of the very sick newborn. So you have a situation of a very crowded and underfunded hospital that translated in issues that probably are also very common to other parts of the global south, in which you have two pregnant women sharing one single hospital bed, and two to three babies sharing one incubator. So that was the situation. So in 1978, Dr. Ray Martinez started to ask if that, what marsupials did, was something that couldn't be done by human bodies in order to face all that drastic reality of what was going on. So what he did, he went and he studied and analyzed marsupials. And it's very interesting and fascinating story. So marsupials have a very short gestational period. It's about 4 to 5 weeks. And baby marsupials, when they are born, in the case of kangaroos, they measure around 2 centimeters. They are born blind, furless, with a very undeveloped lower half of the body. However, it's very interesting that their upper extremities, the fingers, and the muscles and bones of the shoulders are very strong. So the baby marsupials are born in an almost fetal stage. The baby joey gets born, gets expelled through the vaginal canal of the mother, and it immediately grabs the fur of the mother and starts climbing up, guided by the sense of smell and gravity. It climbs for about 5 minutes until it gets into the marsupial pouch and immediately finds a nipple and starts breastfeeding immediately. So this was very interesting because not only that happens, marsupials continue to grow in the pouch, extra womb, for almost a year until they complete a full mature body that allows them to be in nature. So what happened? The baby joeys cannot regulate their body temperature, just like humans. Preterm babies at that time, when the incubators were created in France at the turn of the century, they realized that babies, premature babies, were dying out of hypothermia. They couldn't maintain the body temperature. Well, that happens to marsupials. They are furless, so they can't control. So it's the mother, the heat of the mother, the temperature of the mother that helps it regulate until they grow old enough. So he wondered, can we do the same? Can humans' bodies do the same? So they invaded the kangaroo care program, and it proved, obviously, to be effective. The most important condition was the vertical position of the baby. It had to be there. But the most important aspect is that it has to be skin-to-skin contact. And that's what they would always claim. So they invented, and we know that carrying babies, it's been going on in the history of childbearing around the world for ages. So it's not something foreign to humans as well, to carry your baby. But the idea here was to carry it skin to skin. So he created a program and it started to prove to be successful. Incubators at that time, the most important technology of neonatology, what was doing for the majority of the baby was to keep their temperature regulated. Because small babies used so much energy trying to keep up with their body temperature. So they would not thrive and they would frequently die. So he noticed that the incubators, except for the very sick babies that needed the incubators, but the majority of the babies were just small and they couldn't keep up with the temperature. So he said, can we just send the babies that are okay home with their mothers and families and just get rid of this problem of lack of resources and lack of enough incubators? And so it proved to be successful. You know, to make a long story short, another physician came at that time, Dr. Hector Martinez, and they partnered and he increased the program. It proved amazing successful rates. They would have early discharge, and it was so important that it's exported now to over 100 developing and developed nations around the world. The World Health Organization gave a prestigious award in 1991, and UNICEF funded these two doctors to go around the world spreading the program, which is now, quote unquote, well established around the world in terms of neonatal care, right? So why does it work? And so they started to say that the basic principles of this program were love, warmth, and breastfeeding. And here is where the story gets a little bit iffy. So in biomedical terms, right, we can understand body temperature, we can understand calories, regulation, the use of energy of an underweight baby, and how that is important for them. But to say that if you give the babies love, they will do better, that the babies that are not loved, how do we measure that? We were talking about numbers and statistics, right? So how do we measure the global chart of babies loved around the world to see if we're doing a good example of these things, just to play a little bit. So it is very interesting. I had the opportunity to talk to the last director of the Kangaroo Care Program at the Maternity Hospital, Dr. Alida Pinson, and she would explain in a public presentation that we organized in a series of final conferences, how we understand love. And so she says this, I'm going to read a little bit from her quotes. From the perspective of evidence-based medicine, each treatment should have scientific proof. Love, the way we have seen it, is very hard to explain scientifically. We are intrigued as to why we have to prove something that is so evident. But according to evidence-based medicine, we have to prove that love works. But notice how we physicians don't use the word love. It is very hard for us to mention it because we want to explain everything through a blood test or an X-ray result. So you find in the scientific literature the term attachment to mean what happens to babies when mothers care, caress them, or are affectionate with them and establish early contact. In the mother's case, the term used is bonding to mean the emotional experience of mother. So she starts explaining and she starts getting at the core of things, that there are issues that probably we now understand, such as love, but we also understand that love is really untranslatable into biomedical terms. And however, they are working side by side. They are not negating each other, but they are just talking about different things that are included in one single app. In terms of warmth, it also gets very interesting. She says, warmth doesn't connote just temperature. It's just much more than that. Warmth is to be able to hold one's baby, to let my baby know my smell, for me to know what my baby smells like, for her to listen to my heart rhythm, to get to know her cries, to search for the breast whenever she wants. Scientifically, however, warmth has been defined as the maintenance of a constant body temperature by transferring temperature from a warmer body to a colder body. We know now that baby's temperature increases 0.3 centigrades when she's taken out of the incubator and placed in the mother's body. When the baby stays with the father, the temperature goes up one whole centigrade. So now in the kangaroo care guidelines, it's preferable to have father kangaroos because the body of the male is warmer than the body of the mother. So she continues, which is why we talk about kangaroo fathers and kangaroo families, given that several members of the family learn the kangaroo technique. We had once triplets, and the older siblings went kangaroos for the little ones. So this starts to really represent, and in terms of breast milk, even though it's kind of, she also goes in terms of saying how it is not about just the nutrients that go here and there, but how even the body's mother knows what's best for the babies, but they are saying, we don't like formula, and yet we know that in the guidelines, there are severely compromised babies that we need to also give them formula. So we are kind of calculating how much of the breast milk and how much of the formula is given in these results. So these kinds of ideas can be easily argued as a kind of a syncretic medical system, as a hybrid component, but I think that's just part of the story. I think this is allowing us to think about what happens, how in the struggle of power forces in post-colonial settings, different epistemologies of care are constantly playing out the role of post-colonies in global markets, for example. And how is through this tracing of things not to concluding whether it's a merging or a syncretic mode of care, but rather what it represents in this constant struggle of what are the forces that are being played out and how they are being resolved through time, is that we can see what is at stake, a much larger issue that connects issues of healthcare or issues of care with issues of global dynamics and political economy, for example. So this is the idea that I hope kind of proves that point. So this is not against biomedicine, either biomedicine versus other kinds of care. So you see, this is a typical flowchart algorithm very used in the traditional medical sense that says when a baby is born with less than 2,000 grams, it needs, you know, an intensive medical care assistance, right? If the baby is very sick, then they have the high-tech NICU units, right? All the high-tech incubators to care for those babies. But once the baby reached the 2,000 grams, then they assess them, and they assess the family, and they said, well, does the baby need to continue in the incubator receiving this care, or can it be discharged at home? And so it is part of both things, but it's not necessarily just an integration, right? It is just much more that. It's that battle that I've been trying to explain that is going on. And so from this program, now I'll tell you what happened in the last 20 years of healthcare reform, right? And this is where I have 30 pages to also. Just
finishing. 5 minutes.
Yeah. So neoliberal healthcare reform in Colombia started in 1983. I told you how it moved from what previously was a fragmented healthcare system, which is very traditional in Latin America, with a public-oriented hospital system for the poor, a social security system for workers, and a private sector that has both, you know, for people with a lot of money and people with little money that also use some of the private sector. With the healthcare reform, all the system shifted to an insurance-based for-profit system, right? So all the institutions in the country had to start competing for the bills that they would be able to charge to insurance companies to be paid for. So the maternity hospital had to adapt and shift its mentality from a charity-oriented and publicly-funded care to a managerial kind of orientation in which you compete within the market for those patients and for those bills. So the Kangaroo Care program adapted itself to those things. And then Dr. Lira explains to us how they negotiated with the guidelines and with the committees that set up the prices and the billing system to come up with packages that would be able to be billed in terms of the Kangaroo Care. And when we go back to what it is, we can think that it's very hard to charge for love and warmth, but there are things that can be charged for in the package, right? So the babies that go into Kangaroo Care are divided into three kind of stages. The first stage goes to up to 40 weeks of gestational age. The second stage goes from 40 weeks, which is the normal time that the baby is supposed to be born, like a human pregnancy should last around 40 weeks. The second stage goes from 40 weeks to 6 months, and the third one from 6 months to a year. Each package has a differential price, right? So if they are able to enroll the baby, the sooner they enroll the babies, the bill is larger. And so they would try to have all the babies enroll and fight with the intensive care unit to discharge the baby sooner when it was allowed to be able to then pass that bill to this particular program. So they started to do this as well as other several techniques, but they started to face something that is being very discussed in the literature, which is the particular corruption and managerial practice of the insurance companies, in which they would try to block all the bills and they would return the bills, arguing all sorts of things. So it was very hard for them at the beginning to get all their bills granted by the insurance company. The other thing that happened was that under this new healthcare system, insurance company would start negotiating with all the healthcare providers prices for their services. But the prices led to new fragmentations of the system. So, for example, if one institution would provide very cheap laboratory tests, so the insurance company would hire with them the laboratory tests, but not the x-rays, right? Or even some aspects of the blood test would be hired with one hospital and another with another hospital. So they could not provide anymore the kind of integral care that came with the Kangaroo Care packages. Before the reform, they built a particular house with that UNICEF money, and they had all the services available for the mothers and families and babies, so that when they would come to the hospital, they would be seen by the doctor, by the nurse, by the professional therapy, by the psychologist, by everybody. It was a team of people kind of providing that care. After the reform, that was no longer possible, because all those other issues were fragmented or not even be part of the bill. the healthcare reform left out many, many of the activities that they were doing, and they were not being able to bill for them anymore. So of course, over time, this started to lead into a deepening and deepening economic crisis, which then led in 2006 for the government to declare that the hospital was economically unviable economically, and they decided to close and emptied out the hospital. They transferred the last remaining patients, but however, the workers were not terminated in their contracts. So they started a process, such as a private kind of institution that would declare themselves bankrupt. They started something called a liquidation process, by which, by selling the assets and by reorganizing the bills, they would be able to pay off the pending salaries, which had been stopped for almost a year, plus all the bills with providers and all those kinds of things. The liquidating agent, which is called something like that, decided that if she was to rent the hospital building to another healthcare facility, she could use that monthly money of rent to finish the liquidating process. So what she did, she rented out the hospital to another healthcare institution who came in and started to administer the hospital, opening again services. So from this time, the Kangaroo Care program was closed for about a year. The new institution comes in, starts rehiring a few people, such as Dr. Alida, but they hire her just with 2 hours a day to take care of the Kangaroo Care program. She started fighting. She's also a professor from the National University of Columbia, which I forgot to mention, which there is a very important partnership between the hospital and the School of Medicine of the National University. This is their university hospital. The main university hospital was closed down in 2000, so the medical students did not have a university hospital up to the point that they went on strike for a whole semester because they were receiving medical degrees without having a training practice. And so many of the hospital workers were just fired, and some of them were hired. But in the words of Dr. Alida, she started to face the overburden of the new ways in which managerial administrations overpowers their medical decisions. So the administration put a head nurse in charge of her medical practice. All her medical decisions were being questioned. She started to be mocked as this crazy person who sees that all the babies are much sicker than what they are. She is the physician who terrorizes parents by telling them they're sick babies. But even this person started to overthrow some of her medical decisions. So she would hospitalize a patient and she would arrive the next day and the baby was sent home by the nurse. When she received the exam, she would have to call the patients, have them come back. And so it was this kind of setting. But it was not only the managerial part of the hospital who started to incorporate this kind of harassment to her medical activities, but even her colleagues. Some of their colleagues, some of the medical profession started to adapt to this very precarious labor situation in which their jobs and trying to keep the hospital affiliated to the university meant that they had to kind of obey by the new laws of the market and this new administration. Up to the point that when we last interviewed her, 2 weeks later she resigned to be the director of the Kangaroo Care program. So with this, I just wanted to present to you how, and I think I went much faster than I needed.
You want 30 seconds? Seconds.
So it is interesting to think again back as these, you know, these medical innovation, these medical innovations in particular post-colonies in process of history. What happens with them? What is the history that we can trace out? And how these different epistemologies of care that connect different perspectives of what we are seeing also tell us a much larger story of what's happening through the process of history as these post-colonies become a more, what's the role of the state and the institutions in this more and more play of global health political economy in which there is a direct target, at least for the economic case, of these kind of mentalities. We can think that, again, falling into a simplistic argument, right, that, oh, it's, you know, they're just trying to, finish this kind of particular care and particular strategies, but we know that kangaroo care continues existing all around the country and in all different countries. But the emblematic figure of it, which is this particular program, is really being under attack. That, does that mean that the program is finishing? No. Does that mean that the principles are being finished? No. But does it mean as well that then you have a kind of narrative that talks about the subversive power of these strategies? Let's say, for example, again, love and warmth, you know, as constant symbols of power. That would be another simplistic explanation that gets at these, you know, dichotomic battles of either or. And I think it's just more in the plane how it is being resolved through history that we can see and have a deeper understanding of what's the conditions of how that, that history is going and how we can trace it.
In the thick Freetown air of late, ambulance sirens wail all night long. Most carry burial teams, 3-4 plastic wrapped bodies in the back of each Land Rover. Some carry patients jostling in back from holding center to isolation center, where they will wait on the off chance that a treatment center bed opens up. At the main hospital in Freetown, a constant stream of taxis and vehicles makes their way from the slums, most of the time to be turned away at the gates to drop patients back at their homes where they had been picked up. In the mornings, driving through the city, you can see clusters of people standing in circles around corpses. Nobody seems to know where the bodies come from, who they are, who put them there. They just appear on the street, in gutters, on the sidewalk, and it can be hours before a team comes to pick up the corpse, process it, and bring it to a mass grave. Sometimes I think that Ebola is only going to end when people in this country cease showing any sign of humanity, a British doctor told me a few weeks ago. Less than 30 years old, unspecialized, he had been posted to Freetown 1 year ago as part of a high-level academic partnership with a major European university aiming to provide technical support to the Ministry of Health to strengthen the Freetown hospital system. Now he found himself staffing the main hospital's isolation center with 3 or 4 early 30s colleagues. Quote, you see it happen all over the city. The isolation centers take more patients than they have room for. It becomes unsafe. Health workers contract the disease and things implode and the hospital shuts down. I won't let that happen here. I've got 2 armed soldiers and when we're full, we lock the doors. I tell the ministry that if they force me to open, I'll close up shop and head back to Europe. So increasingly people are dumping their relatives outside in the hospital courtyard rather than take them home again. At the main maternity hospital in the country, every woman with any bleeding is placed in an isolation tent to await testing. For 4 or 5 days, they are locked inside. The floor is so unclean that many non-Ebola positive women have likely contracted the disease just through waiting for their test results. For those who are found positive, there is not a single Ebola treatment unit that will accept pregnant women in the country. 100% of pregnant women with Ebola now die, and a majority of patients admitted to the tent for testing as well die. The WHO shut down the hospital last week after visiting the isolation center in a report that cites scenes so inhumane and gruesome I won't read them here. In Port Loko District, now the epicenter of the rural epidemic, 2 60-bed isolation centers were opened last week by the Sierra Leone military. Within 3 days, both were over capacity by over 20 patients each. And in Kono District, the region in which I've worked for much of the past 5 years, we haven't been able to refer a single Ebola-positive patient to a treatment unit in over 6 weeks. There are no beds available. Instead, local health authorities have improvised their own, turning the ward that was initially intended to hold patients for a few hours before an ambulance could pick them up and bring them to an MSF field hospital into an acting treatment unit. I bring up these vignettes because I'm still getting over my initial shock during my trip to Freetown 3 weeks ago of the bewildering scale that the Ebola outbreak has reached. I say bewildering because just a few months before I was in Sierra Leone, when just 6 people were identified as the first Ebola-positive patients in the country. There's no indication that there has been a major cross-border jump since then. As far as we know, every single one of the 5,000, or probably many more, cases in Sierra Leone can be traced back to those 6 patients. There's a lot of collective head-scratching in Freetown right now. How did this happen? The standard answer refers to what seems to be more of a black box than a real explanatory mechanism, quote, dysfunctional health systems. Paul Farmer says it's an issue of Sierra Leone missing, quote, system, staff, and stuff. The Minister of Health says we had a weak healthcare system before, that weak healthcare system led to this situation. Certainly, Sierra Leone's healthcare system is dismally underdeveloped. In Kono, there are only 2 doctors for 520,000 people. But watching this outbreak unfold, I'm not sure that material, financial, and human resource constraints alone fully explain what has happened. This is how the Ebola outbreak started. On May 26, 6 patients who attended the funeral of a local healer in Guinea showed typical signs of the illness all around the same time when they presented to a clinic in their community of Koindu Village, Kailau District. This occurred after Sierra Leonean health officials and NGO workers had watched the virus ravage villages for 2 months across the border in Guinea. Health workers had attended multiple trainings of the disease, and every clinic in the country was plastered with posters of the signs and symptoms and protocols for how to protect health workers. the Ministry of Health and international partners like Tulane University in New Orleans had refashioned a hospital in Kenema built for another endemic hemorrhagic fever called Lassa fever into an Ebola isolation ward. A lab at Harvard had equipped the hospital's ward with advanced testing equipment. The ministry had placed ambulances in strategic locations, created an emergency hotline to request a testing team, and transport patients once they were found positive to the Kenema hospital. One public health specialist expressed the general thinking at the time in May. Quote, I think it would be fair to recognize the emergency sustainable response on Ebola virus preparedness. For the first time in Ebola's history, that type of wide preparedness has been done in heretofore Ebola, quote, virgin territories, which have ultimately protected or at least uniquely prepared Sierra Leone. The atmosphere in hospitals and clinics was tense as everyone knew a case would eventually come, but the response was activated just as it should have been in the village. The six patients were isolated in the clinic, their blood was drawn safely and tested, special ambulances were sent to retrieve them. But then things began to go awry. Relatives broke down the door to the clinic and carried one patient home to be treated by family members and local healers. Crowds of villagers swarmed around the growing group of Land Rovers in the clinic. Rumors started circulating in Kailao in North Dakota, where I was. They're taking patients to Kenema to die, and quote, they don't even know what happened to their relative after she was locked in the clinic. The patients who had been brought home from the clinic spread the disease to their family members as they were bathed and comforted at home. Very quickly, the local public health care system lost track of where it was spreading and where positive patients had gone. That was the beginning of the Sierra Leone Ebola crisis. The rumors that made their way to Kono at the time centered around two insights. One, Ebola was a near certain terminal illness for those who were diagnosed. People were actually going to Kenema to die. Why then, these rumors seemed to be asking, was it advantageous for the patients to accept isolation and imminent deaths hundreds of miles away from their family members surrounded by men dressed in spacesuits, rather than staying with their family members at home? And two, nobody was communicating with the village families or presumably the patients as they were one by one whisked away to isolation centers. With no sense of when or where patients had died, it seemed no wonder that suspicions of where those ambulances were really going would arise. The early symptoms of this particular strain of Ebola very closely resemble malaria, typhoid, and other endemic tropical diseases, vomiting, diarrhea, and a high fever. Responding Sierra Leonean health workers knew that patients and their families would experience these symptoms in the context of broader life histories of frequent illness, poverty, and social instability. To me, those initial rumors and acts of resistance were a sort of critique of the way the early response was unfolding, and a calling out for more solidarity and empathy in the response. Like counseling families and patients through acceptances and last goodbyes, as one would a terminal illness patient in the United States, even attending to the particularities of individual patients' circumstances, needs, and complexities. But as these rumors, or really insights, spread throughout the forest of Kailao District alongside the virus, the Ministry of Health and NGO partners did not address them by engaging affected communities about why such an urgent response was necessary, or by softening the interactions with community members. Rather, the villages were flooded with police and soldiers. There was no shortage of staff or protective equipment at that time, but no matter how hard they tried, national and local level health workers couldn't get patients and their families to accept isolation. We are left to wonder if we had managed to find a way to keep those six patients isolated if the entire course of the outbreak could have changed. So what went wrong here? What was missing from the response in those early weeks when it was orchestrated on the local level by Sierra Leonean health workers? I think the terms empathy and compassion approach it. I don't think it's accurate that this initial situation, six patients, an open isolation ward, rapid testing, and an effective transportation system, turned into the present scenario, a never-ending flow of tens of thousands of patients for whom we don't have beds because of material or human resource constraints alone. It's very possible that with adequate and patient engagement on why rapid isolation was necessary, an emphasis on communicating with families the status and location of their relatives, and the chance to speak with and witness burials, could attend to these deeply human responses to terminal illness. It would have required only an acknowledgement that Ebola patients and their families might be experiencing universal emotional processes of loss that can be attended to or at least engaged with compassion and care. As these initial tensions mounted and patients increasingly refused to return to isolation centers, I watched as the district's Ebola task force and representatives from new responding humanitarian organizations increasingly circled around the affected villagers' ignorance. That is, they didn't understand how the disease was spreading or that their cultural practices were bringing this on the country. District health management teams were dispersed large amounts of money to essentially develop their own relatively autonomous local responses. most revolved around education, mass sensitization, and, quote, combating ignorance. Pickup trucks with large speakers drove slowly through the market each day, blasting education messages. I sat through a two-hour meeting to interview local hip-hop artists to produce a UNFPA-funded Ebola jingle in order to reach the youth, since, quote, ultimately the youth will play a huge part in determining whether communities resist. One time, after a particularly long and frustrating discussion on how the villagers in Kai Lao were bringing this on themselves, quote, I posited a scenario to Kono's district medical officer, the highest public health authority in the district. I said, if your neighbor's son was brought to a clinic with a fever, the nurse isolated the child and, without explaining what was happening, ordered an Ebola test, and the child was then taken away in an ambulance, and your neighbor never saw his child again, would you want to bring your child to the clinic when he started showing symptoms? The answer was a pause and a no. So why, as Sierra Leonean health workers were tasked with responding to the growing crisis, did this sort of reflexive and empathetic process, this patient could be me, why was that so absent from conversations on what was unfolding? My interest here is an uncomfortable one. How and where is this regime of disregard put into practice on a local level by responding humanitarian organizations and from Sierra Leonean health worker to Sierra Leonean patient? It's possible that such disregard emerges from the material constraints responding health workers knew they would soon face, that these narratives that blame victims absolve health workers from confronting their inability to mount a response at a scale that would match that of disease. A particularly poignant example of this, last year the director of the National Tuberculosis Program told me that he didn't want to know too much about the first patients in the country who had been diagnosed with multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, for he didn't have any idea where to start getting a second line drugs. He said, if I think too much about who they are and what they might be feeling, my head will explode. But these initial interpretations are also emblematic of a modus operandi of understanding and implementing public health interventions within Sierra Leone that increasingly construe patients as more passive recipients of medical services than active subjects with felt needs, emotions, a desire for humane care who will seek out care from alternative sources if public health workers don't attend to their values. In 2010, the Sierra Leonean healthcare system underwent a massive shift in priorities and in its mode of delivering essential healthcare services, a shift that would deeply affect rural patients' relationships to health workers and vice versa. Facing the worst maternal and child mortality rates in the world and extremely low clinic attendance rates, over 75% of women delivered under the care of local midwives at home, the Sierra Leonean government announced the Free Healthcare Initiative, which abolished all user fees for pregnant women and children at public clinics. This initiative was financially backed and largely devised by the British government and was based on the fairly reasonable premise that if financial barriers were removed to clinics, women and children would come to them. The material essence of maternal health response, drugs, supplies, gloves, malaria smears, sterile birthing equipment, could be pushed out through the country's bare bones healthcare infrastructure and maternal and child mortality rates would improve accordingly. The policy was hailed as one of the most progressive in Africa, demonstrating that even an extremely impoverished country like Sierra Leone could, with donor backing, uphold its citizens' right to primary health care. In Kono, in the weeks following the initiative's launching, health workers saw a huge surge in clinic attendance rates, followed by a steep drop. Within 5 days, all Tylenol in the district was stocked out, along with most malaria medications, antibiotics, and most other drugs. Clearly, the plan's creators had anticipated that drug stockouts might happen. On the days when clinics had drugs, maternal and child mortality rates would drop. On the days when they were stocked out, well, it wasn't worse than before. But unfortunately, it was worse than before. Nurses, overburdened with a huge surge in attendance, began treating their patients brusquely and more aggressively, confronting their limited capacity to resolve the material shortages. Many nurses became hostile and narrowed the scope and nature of the care they were willing to provide. Scores of women and children would show up to clinics only to receive a diagnosis and be turned away for lack of drugs. They'd return home frustrated, angry, and with lost trust in the healthcare system. Quote, before nurses didn't get paid much, we were poor, but we cared for patients, a senior nurse who recently returned from the UK told me. Now it's just horrible, the way they talk to patients, the abuse, but also the stress. This is not the profession I entered into. With increased pressure to see and serve as many patients as possible, and with their role as health workers shifted into more deliverers of good than local community caregivers, many observers describe a significant eroding of relations between nurses and the remote communities in which they are posted. Essentially, the Free Health Initiative instantiated a new mode of healthcare delivery in which the possibility, temporality, and valuing of more relational caregiving were deprioritized under the pretext of urgency. In Kono, our organization targeted certain regions to supplement supply chains and eliminate the drug stockouts. In general, however, clinic attendance rates are still below pre-free healthcare initiative levels. In the wake of this policy, which imparted the notion of healthcare as material, transactional, and pharmaceuticalized, you hear such haunting lines like one a woman told me a couple years ago, "If I lose the baby, well, I'd rather just try again. I won't go to that clinic. The nurse doesn't treat us well." Of course, those patients who no longer sought care at public clinics were not lost to follow-up from all forms of care. There's a rich landscape of local healers and practitioners from whom patients draw on, whose usage has only increased in the years since 2010. Patients do not refuse biomedical care to suffer in passivity, but develop long-term relationships with local healers who provide a meaningful language for their illness and jointly engage in very tactile and compassionate care with patients' families. This relational and longitudinal form of healthcare is much more attentive to patients' experiences and desires when seeking to make do through illness and pain that is experienced as chronic rather than acute and distinguishable on a rapid malaria smear. I've even argued that local healers in the wake of the free healthcare initiative have adjusted their practice more towards providing psychological and physical palliative care through their relationships with patients. As the Ministry of Health has floundered to try and bring clinic attendance rates back up to pre-2010 level, the explanations transmitted from the Ministry of Health to the local district health management teams, common in the field of public health, have centered around the need to instill behavior change through education. The term strong cultural reliance has been deployed with increasing frequency by local public health authorities to describe their fellow community members' use of local healers. A dizzying array of interventions have sought to educate women out of using traditional birth attendants, and even hired traditional birth attendants to act as community health workers can condemn their own practice. None of these interventions have budged clinic attendance rates. The Free Healthcare Initiative has had an enduring legacy in the country in that it quite concretely institutionalized a way of conceiving of patients as passive recipients of pharmaceuticalized services, not active subjects with their own priorities and processes for healing and dying, entangled with emotional experiences of being ill. The implications of this MO have endured on many, many planes, from a constantly changed medical record system that emphasizes simply the breadth of patients nurses serve, every patient reduced literally to a tally mark in a large notebook as the only marker of their visit, to the push system of drug procurement in which nurses have no capacity to order the drugs they feel necessary for their practice, but rather are delivered a stock each month that they find a way to, quote, push onto the surrounding community. It's altered the notion of a clinician's role from, as a nurse quoted earlier, one who cares and attends through a relationship with her patients to a mere delivery mechanism for health materials. If patients don't receive and seek those materials out, it's because they don't know better. And so it has been this dehumanization in how public health workers within the country relate to and intervene in patients' worlds that I believe set the stage for the way the unfolding Ebola crisis was understood and the response orchestrated in the weeks following those initial cases. A response was designed with the emotional experience of facing such a traumatic terminal illness held at arm's length. Ebola patients were confronted brusquely and treated more as disease carriers than as human beings with emotions and families. With an urgency that precluded the possibility of attending to the particularities of individual patients' experiences, the response turned aggressive. Subsequently, patients turned inward to their communities and families for more attentive care. 6 months in, with the outbreak raging at a scale none of us imagined, I do think international health officials are beginning to recognize what went wrong here. The WHO and CDC no longer produce reports or protocols on burials. They are protocols for, quote, dignified burials. The transition towards decentralized Ebola care units, which are smaller tent structures within villages for isolating patients, is promoted partially so that patients will be closer to their families. The term loved ones is used with increasing frequency at emergency operations center meetings to describe what to do with patients and bodies, restoring them to some modicum of humanity, which might enable NGO representatives to understand why families might be resistant to having them taken away. But among Sierra Leonean health officials, this disregard of care remains unsettlingly present. Quote, "What this country needs more than anything we've learned is collective enlightenment," a high up official in the office of the president told me 3 weeks ago. "These rural people have brought this on themselves and now us all." The question that remains, of course, is what inspires this institutionalized disregard of care and empathy internationally. I'm not sure I have the answer to that question, but I end with an email I received from a high up official in a major funding body providing feedback for a concept note that Well Body Alliance and Partners in Health had submitted for a comprehensive continuum of Ebola care, including community health workers versed in compassionate and empathetic counseling and a high-quality treatment center that emphasized the value of humane and effective medical care. The funder would be interested in funding more community health workers to provide education, but they, quote, believe that it is more appropriate for Ebola treatment centers to practice less aggressive care with Ebola patients, for example, avoiding IV therapy in favor of oral therapy, in order to raise the number of treatment beds and thus expand coverage of effective isolation of infected persons. Essentially, they refuse to fund effective Ebola care. At best, this can be read as a kind of defeatist pragmatism, enabling the writer to avoid the moral implications of the stance under the pretext of urgency and material constraints, i.e., we need beds so quickly, resources are so stretched, we can't prioritize saving lives and making people feel comfortable, we need to isolate as many people as quickly as possible. At worst, it expresses a kind of radically over-technical handling of an emergency facing Ebola patients' humanity because they are poor, because they seem to be suffering in abjection, and because they are assumed not to have other worlds and sources of care to draw on, i.e., we support less effective and humane medical care so the disease will run its course more quickly, people will die faster, and the turnover in beds will increase. But where in this calculus are the people who will populate those treatment beds? People with agency, emotion, families, a desire to live, and a fear of dying. We've learned through this Ebola experience that rehumanizing such an emergency response is both morally justifiable and a matter of effective public health. If we don't attend to patients as people, they simply won't come. And still, the most horrific sight of all, the taxis and ambulances continue their never-ending weaving towards the Freetown hospitals and the terrible conditions inside their isolation centers. 6 months in, we may be getting unsettlingly close to that European doctor's prescription. As the virus tears through families and slums, spreading through acts of empathy and compassion, perhaps Sierra Leoneans are ceasing to care.
So these thoughtful and compelling presentations raise many issues about the delivery of health care. There's an overarching critique of an exclusive focus on the technical aspects of medical care. A fundamental argument in both presentations is that excellent technical care may be an oxymoron in that medical care cannot be excellent if it neglects human feelings and emotion. A specific issue that that Cesar's presentation raised concerns what might be called the epistemology of care. How do we know what we think we know about what is best for mothers and their children? He quotes Dr. Lita Pinzon talking about love and warmth for premature babies, saying, we are intrigued as to why we have to prove something that is so evident. Yet isn't it the case that treating biomedical and family care with equal respect also means subjecting them to equally serious scrutiny and testing? Indeed, it's clear that Cesar does not see biomedicine and family care as being in conflict, as he states that the larger interest is in the well-being of the baby, and babies need a varied array of practices, including biotechnologies, love, warmth, and breast milk. The intermingling of these practices has allowed infant mortality in Colombia to continue to decline over time, as seen in this figure, which is based on data from the World Bank, even while these struggles about how care should be delivered and what is billable and what is not have played out. One thing I thought was particularly interesting is the tension that he mentions between what is billable and what is not. He is talking about in the context of colonialism, but this is also something that's often discussed in the context of American medicine. If you recall the debate over the Affordable Care Act, one of the real hot button issues was the so-called death panels, where the proposal was to allow doctors to bill for giving end-of-life advice to patients. That's what the so-called death panel was. And it was rejected that that could be built. So these issues come up in many different contexts and not only in a colonial context. So turning to Rafi's presentation, he thankfully spared us some of the most horrific details about what has been happening in Sierra Leone, but I think we can all agree that the presentation was hair-raising enough. the context of the Ebola outbreak is one in which the potential conflict between a purely biomedical approach and a more humanistic approach is particularly fraught. On the one hand, as he argues, a more humane approach from the outset might have allowed the outbreak to be contained. On the other hand, the continuing outbreak forces caregivers to take drastic measures, like barring the doors to new patients, however sick they might be. His firsthand account suggests that a lack of system staff and stuff is not the root cause of the disaster, but it certainly seems to have been a contributing factor. Raphael tells us about the earlier 2010 free healthcare initiative in Sierra Leone. It appears that the abolition of user fees caused clinics to be overwhelmed and drugs to stock out, perhaps resulting in the brusque and inadequate care that people did receive when they came. Then the resulting erosion in trust may have been an underlying factor allowing Ebola to spread. Raphael also discusses a parallel system of informal care. Again, I thought this was interesting to think about in an American context. In the US, we like to think that there aren't any equivalents to the local healers that he's talking about. But in fact, there's a huge army of therapists, life coaches, counselors of every sort. And they exist largely outside the regular medical system. It's interesting to wonder whether this industry also exists as a response to the depersonalization of medical care, and also to wonder whether this large army of alternative caregivers could be mobilized more effectively than they are today to promote the public health. As a last thought, I also looked up the trajectory of infant mortality in Sierra Leone, which had levels that were among the worst in the world even before the current crisis. I think these numbers, which are also taken from the World Bank, need to be taken with a large grain of salt. However, they are strangely encouraging in that they show a rapid fall in infant mortality in Sierra Leone up to 2008, which was only partially reversed by the free care initiative. You see that little uptick at the end. Oops. Sorry, I didn't mean to do that. It is to be hoped that after the crisis, the country will return to that trajectory of rapid improvement.
Yes, Serena?
Sure. Thank you both for your presentations. They really bring out the linkages between experiment and humanitarianism and care as, you know, for practices. That's really dynamic. So I was really struck thinking about the case study about the kangaroo program and the incubator. And the incubator is a metaphor that's been taken up in the world of big philanthropy and social innovation and social entrepreneurship now as an umbrella for training programs, for especially for young people. It's really predominant on this campus. To initiate programs that are market-based approaches to global health. So, you know, the selling of mobile apps or toilets or different things to the quote-unquote bottom billion people in the world, that's a profit-based model. So my question is actually targeted at Rafi. I'm curious about how Ebola, the crisis of Ebola, might be a sort of reawakening in the field of global health around health system strengthening. How in your observations on the ground, you see the role of international philanthropy and perhaps some of these sort of social entrepreneurship framed initiatives, and also how you anticipate how Ebola might be a catalyst thinking more systemically about global health and Africa.
Great. Okay, so we have Peter.
Yes, I actually thought I would have to go back to the theme that was emerging in first panel of accountability and ask you to all think about accountability. So I was struck by the work necessitated by a concept like love, the translation work that's necessary to make it visible. Can you make love accountable in a sense? Do these vocabularies, how do they map onto each other? Or care accountable? To what extent can compassion be a part of something that you would assess on when you're looking at a health system. and care for death, the accountability of how you care for death in the health system, as well as the focus on life.
Great. Clara?
Yes, I thought these were really very interesting papers, and what the question that actually came up, a few questions that came up for me was just out of curiosity to think about, it seemed that both of the papers were actually, in a way, arguing or offering a, showing us the, in a way to ask us, what are the non-cognitive dimensions of care? And that actually, so on the one hand, I can think about, for example, that, for example, the feminist philosopher and theorist Eva Federkutte, who's done a lot of work on care, and arguing that, a discourse of rights or rights liberalism are actually, to think care through simply a question of resources and social movements through a discourse of rights actually in a way, eclipses that kind of what she would call full-blown care. So that how to then think about that the non-cognitive dimension of care that actually escapes regimes of accountability that is that actually cannot simply in any simple way be captured in a regime of accountability, and to ask if it is in fact desirable that it in fact be accounted for through a metric. The second is actually to think again about care in terms of not necessarily a care as a right or some ideal. Like, unfortunately, it comes back to my talk, but like care as an ideal, but rather, actually how in the proximity, like Rafi's actually showing, like it's a question of proximity, right? That is actually very difficult not to care, and it's a question of what I would say that Harry Englund brings up very well, who works in Malawi, the idea of existential obligations, the existential pressure that actually is a result of living in proximity with others. So I guess I just wanted to kind of ask you if you could maybe think a little bit more around the non-cognitive dimensions of care outside the question of a rights framework or rights liberalism, and not simply bound into an idea of the securing of resources.
There are many, many, many things here, and I think there is something very interesting and very beautiful when we think about care in these, and you also mentioned in your presentation, in this not enlightened way to see care. What are the other possibilities that other epistemologies just do, not by knowing, but by being in proximity and by addressing, what it's really crucial for me to be here. And it, at the hospital, and here we have José Ricardo, who really was one of the main people of founders of this tradition of a different kind of epistemology of care that comes from Latin American social medicine traditions, in which, the aspect of even trying to redefine all these issues about health, but really trying to diminish as much as possible its proximity with this rationalization about life through biomedical discourse of care, and bring it in more to what is it in everyday life that connects us, and that, as your paper, I think, brought it very, very significantly. And what is what we are supposed to be doing here to be better, right? So it just brings us to another different dimension of what is it. And then you start seeing proximities of what needs to happen, and these kind of inventions that go back to even just being present but also thinking. It's not that other not cognitive doesn't have necessarily a thinking process or a logical process about it. And I had to exclude, but this is interesting because it resonates with ideas and discussions about modern thinking and premodern thinking and all those kinds of also philosophical debates of what it is. And what I couldn't present was, for example, the origin of the incubator. The incubator was a copycat from when this famous French gynecologist saw in a zoo how poultry were kept alive, you know, through bulbs and water heat bottles. So he said, like, well, let's do the same. So it is also, when we think about these rationalities, it's also very fixed in you know, this modern outbreak of technology, when they are also the result of a kind of the progression of history. And even like the infant mortality rates kind of reflect, it's also like a matter of how, you know, at the same time that we are advancing, we have particularities in the ways of how we go about things. So for example, connecting that with accountability, Dr. Alira told us a very beautiful story that in this hospital, of course, is very frequent, the issue of adolescent pregnancy, right? So she says, so we have this situation, a 12-year-old girl who just delivered, and here comes the father, who is a 15-year-old boy. And according to the law, he was a predator. So he's put in juvenile detention. And he comes daily to see the baby, and they don't let him see the baby. And so they are both crying. And so I get the baby and I get the mother, and they miss each other and they want to be with each other. So she goes there and she puts the baby and presents the baby on the other side, because the baby's in the incubator, and they touch hand and they say, she said, everybody was crying. And then the social worker comes and says, well, I'll have to report this, because he's not supposed to be close to the person. So what kind of accountability is also that, right? Like, she's just doing in the act of what needs to happen, right? What needs to be done. And yet, that's not going to be able to translate. It's going to be another whole of political debate on whether that's possible. Even the timing in itself, as you were thinking about the timing, is just so crucial to make things happen in a way that escape larger parameters of accountability as how we think about it. So I think there is a very interesting tension about of these, you know, reaching to universalities or these institutions of global that need kind of universals to go about its global influence, and yet there are the particularities and dimensions that's not to say that they cannot be accounted for, but they just happened differently in different historical moments. And if we politicize that question about what's the care, then they have to take back and take into account what has been the particular historical process by which the things that need to happen and call for accountability are different, depending on the different kinds of aspects that are being there. So what it's interesting to me, when the last comment, is that from the social medicine tradition, there is more and more the idea of talking less about healthcare and talking more about life and well-being, you know, and what's meaningful, what brings us together, what needs to happen, and how in these issues, as your comment also mentioned, is not that then, you know, technologists and you know, all these things are the devilish, but also taking into account that technology and markets are being co-produced all the time, and that there is a lot of the technology that is very harmful, right? And so, for example, these doctors at the hospital are very wise at understanding that not everything from the evidence-based medicine and international guidelines is to be incorporated, because it's not but for the benefit of the children and families. So they're very strategic as to what they implement and what they don't, or how they implement it, and in what cases. And so I think it, you know, this is kind of the issues of tension that I see.
Yeah, I mean, I think since I've been steeped in this whole thing through the role of a kind of a health worker, that's how I'll answer these questions, although I think they're very interesting about how it, you know, does compassion and love and care elude sort of accountability. But I do think, so I think the first question is in this case, is one of leadership, is it's very unclear still who should have stepped up and orchestrated this response in the start. Clearly it wasn't done well. You know, Paul Farmer says I should have done it because no one else was doing it. That wasn't really appropriate. Unclear what the World Health Organization, you know, if that's their role in 2014. MSF had absolutely no interest in playing any sort of leadership role on a national level. So we don't even know who could have held this accountable. Although this program, the Free Healthcare Initiative, was totally devised over a dinner at the DFID office in the UK with the president of Sierra Leone, really born out of this sort of British idea of what Sierra Leoneans needed. And there are very concrete ways in which this kind of political economy of disregard has been institutionalized, is I think my argument, in terms of training of community health workers, for instance, to be sort of what, like when they're brought into these workshops on Ebola contact tracing, the premise is always that they're doing sensitization is the term. Medical school, nursing school, there aren't modules on the sort of like art of nursing anymore, whereas there used to be, I think, and now it's much more about sort of these are the services in which you materially deliver. And our organization within Kono has had sort of, Kono District has been relatively spared so far, in large part because the community helpers that we train, we do a lot of, you know, role-playing and sort of empathy-inducing activities, although I don't really like that term, about sort of what, you know, when is a time when you felt excluded from the healthcare system and what do you wish a health worker had said? Yeah, I guess I would say that I think that sort of, in many ways, compassion has been institutionalized out of the medical training and healthcare delivery system and therefore could be put into it, although who should be orchestrating that, I'm not really sure. I also think a really interesting question that we don't know is how will these non-cognitive forms of care be changed in the wake of this outbreak that have so, I mean, the outbreak is spreading through care. You know, I spent a lot of time interviewing survivors and it's very clear that you see a family, one by one, the patients will be turned away and they'll take them back into their homes, they'll wash them, and then another person will die, another person will die, another person will die, until finally someone just sort of boots them out. And some of them survive and some of them don't, but it's like created this very new way, I think, probably, a new fear of tactile care, which was very central to how Sierra Leoneans related to each other when they were sick. So I think that'll be a very important thing for anthropologists to study after it's over. In terms of philanthropy, a lot of my work here, kind of unfortunately, is dealing with philanthropists who, so basically, I mean, the responses was very explicitly divided into the British government takes the UK, American government takes Liberia, French government takes Guinea, and a conference in London. And individual philanthropists have been very confused about where they fit into this because the scale of the problem and the amount of money that's being directed is so eclipses what most philanthropists can do. The DFID, for instance, the British funder in Sierra Leone, is only interested in funding hot spots, current hot spots. They're not interested in funding places like Kono that have decimated healthcare systems that are definitely going to turn into a hot spot. So it seems like what the Gates Foundation calls it is the philanthropy community should be building firewalls, investing in these areas that have not yet reached international attention. I think a lot of people are talking about how Ebola may be a sort of catalyst for, and the discourse is definitely there about this being an issue of health system strengthening at this point. But the major responding organizations like MSF and IMC, that's not really their focus, as we heard earlier. So it's yet, and it's also, it is complicated because while this is about system staff and stuff at some level, Ebola is also a different ballgame. And, you know, Partners in Health, which I now work for, likes to kind of over and over again say, we've dealt with cholera, now we can deal with Ebola. And that's not entirely true because there's a lot of risk involved, it's complicated, the structures are different, it's difficult to turn an Ebola care unit into any sort of long-lasting healthcare infrastructure, and it requires a lot of assumed risk on the part of health workers in order to treat this. So it's like, in theory, these conversations are happening. I don't think people have fully figured out how that can work.
Let's collect a set of questions, and for the sake of time and for us keep learning from you guys, let's try to be as condensed as we can in our comments, or questions, and then we'll have time to hear more from the panel. So just get a card.
I'd like to cover a question that Gita raised in the first session of the day about the social movements. And if in the two cases, if there was some kind of social movement against, in the case of Colombia, the health reforms, and in case of Ebola, we have the epidemic in Sierra Leone, against the disregard in terms of health care. And another question was specifically for Cesar, and in what extent he thinks that human rights, not in the sense of law and accountability, but in the sense of one of the sense of Sophia bring us in terms of being a reference, a normative horizon to orient health practices can help the construction of this new epistemology.
I have also listed myself for Cesar too, building up on José Ricardo's questions. We also know Colombia is also famous, not just only for its privatization, neoliberalization of welfare, but also for strong judicialization, you know, for using the courts then to make something else happen. So can you tell us a bit more, how could that be mobilized, and which kind of role does that do, and how does that reshape, you know, patienthood, you know, ideas of care delivery? And I was very intrigued, you know, with Janet's comments and panel and graphics at the end. So if we look at this aggregate, this data, you know, do we see, let's say, some form of care, a more like a populational kind of care? I was wondering if we could see care from the perspective of the state or of development institutions, but then the care has to be at the level of an aggregate, which results this, okay, we all want, you know, less infant mortality, right? So there is a form of care there, but it seems so disconnected from the kinds of practices that you both spoke. So I wonder which kinds of practices lead to that outcome, which could be read as a form of care in a macro level. Mateus?
Yeah. I'm wondering whether you think there's something special about emergencies that requires us to turn off the part of us that is human and to sort of think with muscle memory rather than your heart. So, you know, think of when you get on a plane, right? The first thing you're told is that during an emergency, you don't put the mask on your child, which would be the human thing to do. You're told to put it on yourself first, right? You're supposed to be selfish. You're supposed to follow rules to the letter, because during an emergency, we get tunnel vision. We don't think straight, right? You want to seek out that guidance of something more abstract. And so I'm wondering, you know, is your argument that this other kind of dimension to care should come after the crisis? Or is it something that we should be doing sort of in the midst of it all?
Sebastian?
So, yeah, I was, thank you both. I was really struck by this presentation about the difficulty or the inevitability of love as entering into a kind of care, and the only partial translation of warmth as a way to leave some space for care that's outside of that space medicine. And I was wondering, what does this non-entry into a space medicine protect? Is it protect the status of others, perhaps, as givers of care that is different from that of nurses or of machines or of incubators? But what's the status of this knowledge of being mother that is staying outside of this form of knowledge?
Great, you have anything, Olivia?
Yeah.
Then we have another round. Yes.
Okay. I had to think because I'm not quite sure that I will translate correctly in Portuguese to English, but to Cesar, I really want to bring the discussion for the clinic, the encounter of patient and the professional. And we're talking about accountability, and I was thinking, how do you see in your researches and everything the responsibility of the professional with the patient? I've been seeing some kind of, I'm not responsible for that, okay, next patients, and how do you see that in the encounter? And for Rafael, if you could, I really like you to talk a bit about more the traumatic encounter. How is this for you in field? And use this word, and I think it's perfect, the traumatic encounter.
So, guys, you have 2 minutes each, and Janet, you have 1 minute. So we have 5 minute response, and then we have one more round, so we will leave with questions. We'll leave this session with questions from the other people who want to speak.
Okay, social movements, this is something I'm very interested in. I'm not sure. I think that there are huge schisms emerging between public health authorities and rural affected communities that I've never seen before, and people have been talking about this turning into another war after this is over. So it hasn't been organized or really catalyzed yet, but two people were shot in Kona last week over a protest relating to someone being isolated, so it's very tense. some form of care happening, you know, what's beneath the meta data. Clearly there is some form of care happening and also sort of slightly improving socioeconomic context can also describe that, you know, because these are very, very basic things that no one should really die of and are sort of intricately connected to broader social determinants of health. Within Sierra Leone, the healthcare system has completely shut down, and the statistics that are beginning to come out, just basic about maternal and infant mortality rates, are like just completely through the roof because there's no hospitals or clinics open in the country right now. So this is going to be a very complicated thing to restart. Emergency sort of making us move with muscle, not heart. I think that's kind of my point, but I guess I would question what you things that seem to us an emergency sort of phenomenologically to a Sierra Leonean is not an emergency in the same way, potentially. You have to sort of take into account the experience in their own sources of care that they have to draw them through what to us may seem like a completely unlivable situation, like a child mortality rate of 20%. And so there was this sort of, the devisors of the plan thought this was such an emergency, we can just sort of distribute as many pills as possible, and this is actually something that Sierra Leoneans had a way of understanding and processing and dealing with, and not to say that it wasn't traumatic to lose your children at all, but there was, something was missed in the process, I guess, is my argument, if that makes sense. And the traumatic encounter, for me personally, I mean, I think to me, the traumatic encounter was sort of being in Freetown recently and feeling like there's no plan or foreseeable mechanism how this is going to end, and to see these sort of meetings of the greatest minds in global health supposedly orchestrating this, and a lot of people saying I don't know what to do, which is kind of terrifying to see in person. So that was most traumatic.
So very rapidly touching on some of the things, this question that Sebastian asks about staying out of knowledge to be able to provide love, I would just bring an image that I think kind of captures a little bit how I see the situation. When you have a kangaroo baby in your chest, you can lovingly provide the antibiotic to the IV, right? So it's not a necessarily fight with the ontology of technology as against you, but how you transform that. And I'm sure that an antibiotic that you give with love through that has a different sort of effect in both bodies that are doing the thing. So it's just that kind of thing that the call is for. In terms of the clinical encounter, very rapidly, people comment, and we've seen a change, a deep transformations of the kind of care and humanity that physicians can bring to the clinical encounter, because they have to stop caring. They cannot care anymore because they are overloaded, they are underpaid, they can spend time with the patients, they are going to be not only not paid for that, but yelled at, they're going to be assumed as wasting resources, you're going to fulfill. So, and the physicians, the professors see that even in the residents. And they said, we're losing them. They don't have interest anymore. They're just pay attention to the watch. And I think it's just a transformation within the whole structural way in which also we can see how the clinical encounter is being transformed. And we can see even here in the US, as you were mentioning, you can see the nurse of the emergency care that is taking you, saying to exactly the same 50 patients that you see per day, oh, okay, so with this sleep, go to your iron, and I hope you feel better. And I hope you feel better, and I hope you feel, and I worked as an interpreter here in the hospital, and the first time I heard it, I was like, oh, she's so nice. And then I said, and so people in Colombia would ask, but why do we have to teach humanitarian care? Aren't we humans? And they said, we lost it, and why does it have to be the medical school that start teaching humanitarian care? Are gonna biomedicalize, kind of. So there is a problematic way about it. And in terms of social movements and this idea, for example, the judicialization of care, it's a very interesting link between your individual conscious racings about that you are a citizen with rights, as Sophia was saying, right? And whether that translates or not into a larger sense of the necessary mobility to change the status of things. Because it's so this discourse of rights comes also from a very liberal individual-based tradition that it's my rights that I'm fighting for. and I have rights, versus vis-a-vis another thing of a larger structure. But so there is an interesting connection that it can go both ways. It's not either that the individual rights are just from the individual, as well as that the social and collective battles and forces through social movements can also enforce individual rights, but should go farther than that, because then they are also limited. And that's where a lot of the discussions about the human rights discourse find it problematic, right? Because it starts putting us in a way that it's about the individual. So we don't contemplate trees, or we don't contemplate, or it's harder to think about caring for others when we link about the rights of each individual person, and we kind of isolate again the ontology of what we are fighting for.
Sure.
Right, so in my 1 minute, I just want to respond to this sort of idea that's floating around that there's some kind of conflict between evidence-based care and humanitarian care. I think, Cesar, you said that that was not the case. And I think the whole point of the panel is that you really need both. So when you were talking about how kangaroo care has been adopted all over the world, it's not because people suddenly woke up and realized that love was important. It's because it was proven to work, right? And so it makes sense that it works, but it still needed to be shown. And mothers didn't know that carrying their babies skin to skin would result in great improvements. You know, in many cultures, mothers swaddle babies, which is not the same as having skin to skin care. So it's not like we all just know what we have to do and we need to introspect about it. We need evidence. And in the example of Ebola as well, I think Rafi made a really compelling argument that containment would have worked better in Sierra Leone with more compassionate care. But at the same time, compassionate care is wiping out entire families because they touch their loved ones, right? So people do have to know that is a very dangerous thing to do. So you need both aspects, and it's not really that, you know, one trumps the other.
So we will collect, we have a few people who want to ask questions. So we had Sophia, we had Amy, and I forgot your name.
Simone.
Okay, yes, go.
Okay, thank you, all three of you. You know, rights impose obligations on a population level. And so states are responsible at a population level, let's say for reduction of infant mortality. And that's why it was really clear in terms of this, looking at infant mortality rates as a measure. And what it doesn't tell us is the process by which that infant mortality was reduced. It just tells us that absolute rate. So I was thinking about, at an aggregate level then, we need to think about what would be a measure then for care. Because we need to be able to think about what that would look like. And I was interested in the thoughts of the three of you around that and how we make those sorts of things.
Okay, Simone?
I'll be back to the issue of love in the alternative law, because I'm a big fan of kangaroo care, and I was thinking about the situation that we had before the establishment of the kangaroo care, sputum care in Brazil. And a mother or a father could love the baby deeply, but have no access to the baby, have no access to intensive care where the baby was, but had no, was not allowed to touch the baby and so on. So can we think about a pragmatic love or ways, different ways to empower this love in terms of empowering mothers and parents in general to have this, instead of this powerless law, how this law could be instrumentalized. And I think that, yes, we have to force ourselves to some imagination to think about what would be ways to express this love in a safe and effective way. So I think that comfort care is a very important example of how we can imagine this new technology. The other thing is about physical intimacy. It is very interesting because in the case of Ebola, we have to avoid any kind of physical contact. And there is a healing power. I would say like Janet was saying about the army of carers that we have now, the life coach and so on, because there's something that we do not find in the regular medical care. So the role of physical contact as a part of care, it's becoming so important that it's even institutionalized, as is the case of can you care? Do you see other opportunities to use the issue of physical intimacy? Because there's lots of other things like in childbirth and breastfeeding and so on.
Great. Amy?
So Jen and Sophia's comments both made me think back to Peter's really interesting question earlier about the, you know, how can something like love or dignity be brought into bureaucracy, and how that kind of statistical legibility, you know, is part of billability. And so it made me think of Michael Porter's idea of value delivered to patients. And I was wondering if any alternative metrics like that are being or could be used to look at something like Ebola, and what would that do?
Alicia?
Just a real quick question, because I was really fascinated by kangaroo care as a model and sort of the comparison of birth and sort of early care, or care for babies in their earliest days to in humans, to that of marsupials. And I wondered whether, perhaps not in Colombia where there are restrictive abortion policies and where the Catholic Church has really strong influence, but perhaps in other countries where the model has been exported, I wondered how this sort of notion of when life begins, how kangaroo care might affect discourse around when life begins and perhaps debates about abortion care. And then a really quick question for Rafi, sort of related to neoliberalism. I recently read an article that talked about how IMF policies really placed a lot of fiscal constraints on sort of Sierra Leone, Liberia, and the countries affected by Ebola today, which sort of really which undermine their health systems and their ability to address Ebola effectively. I just wondered whether you could speak about how much of that you've heard as you worked in the field.
Any?
Very quickly, just kind of a wrap up of all the questions. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the multiplicity of scale. So I'm talking about the global and the local level. And how can you, like from your work and your experience, how can you influence people's perceptions of what is a priority at the local level and the global level, and how much the global intervention could actually be helpful to help some of your local initiatives, vice versa?
Guys, these are amazing questions. People are already assembling outside for our colloquium, which is part of our seminar, and Keith Whale, our speaker, is already here. So, guys, you have 1 minute each, and then we will continue over the brief lunch and throughout the day, because we just have to get going, because the people are already assembling outside, and they want to come into the room to join us. More people will join us for the colloquium, okay? So, guys, some closing comments?
One thing about the measuring and the scales of care, I think actually love and dignity and care, I think they are powerful because they are unmeasurable. And I think that's the risk that I think we should try to avoid as much, because then they get co-opted and they start meaning different things. And I think by keeping them like that, I think we keep alive some sense of transformation. So their power is not numerical or scalable, I think, at least, you know, as an initial reaction. But I understand where that comes from. And I think the interesting of where life begins is more interesting, not for the kangaroo care, but for the high-intensive perinatology and neonatology, that they take babies with less and less weight at birth. So they are keeping, and that's a very interesting discussion that goes on in neonatology. You know, like a baby is born with 750 grams, you know, like this, and they go and they do all sorts of things with all sorts of complications. So was it worth, you know, spending, you know, whatever $1 million in that and didn't survive? And the multiplicity of scales, it's just like a huge question that I so far don't know.
Yeah, I would agree about the sort of immeasurability of it. I would say, however, there's a huge amount of research happening in Sierra Leone from other disciplines, mostly social sciences and looking at sort of all survey-based things, sort of trust-building exercises, bringing a nurse and the village together around some tree and doing some Sierra Leonean ritual to bridge trust. I mean, it's very essentializing, but it also indicates that this is an interest from different perspectives and fields. I think this sort of like physical intimacy question is very interesting for Ebola, because there's a lot of questions about what kind of alternative to physical intimacy could we provide patients and their families, whether it's sort of making glass panels that they can talk to their family members. I mean, there's probably some physical medical efficacy in that, or watching bodies be buried. Now the WHO is recommending that you always allow the family to put the dirt on the coffin after it's in the ground. That's interesting. And then in terms of IMF policy, I mean, structural adjustment kind of dramatically affected the way a lot of these West African countries invested in health systems. It's also complicated. The civil war in Sierra Leone was kind of, I think, the main determinant in this massive exodus of health professionals and this need to sort of build from scratch. And, it's interesting that the free healthcare initiative is sort of almost the opposite of structural adjustment, because it depended on the health, on the government investing money that it clearly didn't have and was going to run out by the government in a healthcare system it couldn't sustain, which was then worse than prior. So it's a strange sort of flip-flop now. I don't know.
Jimmy?
Okay, so if you want to hold healthcare systems accountable for providing human care and love, you have to be able to measure it. Because if you can't measure it, then there's no accountability. So how do you measure it? That's a really hard question. But I think, for example, Rafi suggested in his remarks, if people aren't going to the clinics,
clinic attendance,
that's showing that people don't feel that they're going to be treated well at the clinic. So that's a very direct and obvious measure. And I think there's other measures like that. In the American context, we have patients fill in surveys and ask whether they feel like they've been treated with respect. So there are a lot of different ways that you can try and measure these things. On the IMF question, far be it from me to defend the IMF, but there is this issue. If there is no money, right, and you create a system, and then the system collapses because there's no money, and you have a lot of debt, how has that helped anybody, right? So a lot of the structural adjustment policies are actually just trying to get countries to live within their means and plan and create a system maybe more slowly than people would like, but one that's actually sustainable.
So in this incredibly inspiring, surprising with the kangaroos, lovingly provocative and sober note, we end the session. We thank our presenters.